Hello and welcome back to the Grapple Theory Podcast. Thank you so much for joining us once again. Now, this week we continue our month-long series of podcasts around Black History Month in the UK, talking to black wrestlers about representation on the scene, about how it's evolving and growing and hopefully improving, most importantly. We're going to be talking to them, we have been talking to them throughout this month, about all of that, plus about their own careers and about, you know, life in and out of the ring. Now, today we've got a very special guest joining us. She is one quarter of the uprising in Eve Wrestling. She's also got a great singles career under her belt. She's absolutely ferocious in the ring. You don't want to mess with her at all. But she's got a heart of gold outside the ring. And we had a great chat here about representation in wrestling, about the uprising, about Eve, about her singles career, and about her work sort of in the ring, but not on wrestling shows, in the form of things like TV appearances and a sort of more theatrical side of wrestling. So all of that to look forward to. You're in for a real treat today. I'm delighted to welcome to the Grapple Theory Podcast this week, Livvy Grace. Livvy, thank you so much for joining us. It's a pleasure to have you here. Now, recently, we've just been starting the podcast by talking to our guests about the last 12 months, because it's been about a year since wrestling returned. How, in and out of the ring for you, how have you found the last year or so?
Outside of the ring, I've been pretty cool. Like, even throughout the whole, like, COVID, I have a day job, like, I'm an engineer by day. I've just been working through that. But in terms of wrestling, like, I feel like I'm doing pretty well. Like, I've got a variety of different shows that isn't just strictly professional wrestling. I do quite a bit of theatre-related stuff as well. Mm. And I was recently on ITV2 in like, July, June sort of time. So it's been proper crazy for me.
Yeah, that's awesome. We'll get on to that in a second. I've got that listed down to ask you about. But one thing I want to ask you about, you mentioned, like, other stuff as well as sort of just purely wrestling. In the ring, and that brings on to something you had going on like a couple of weeks ago from where this is going out, which was Restival over in Islington, which is incredible. I didn't get to go on any of the shows, unfortunately. The week there was manic and I didn't get the chance to go to any of them, but from what I heard, all the shows were fantastic, and it really seemed like a little, like, what it was meant to be, I guess, a little festival of wrestling. Over in Islington, right. So how much fun was that to work on?
Oh, God, it was absolutely insane. Like, I'll be honest, I was quite nervous working it, knowing that there's about seven shows on, and I did, like, five of them. So, like, it was long days, but it's really nice just hanging out with some of the people that I was hanging out with. My biggest love for it is that it wasn't, again, it wasn't just strictly wrestling. There was in the theatre wrestling related things like Mummy Versus and NHS Smackdown and Mythos as well. It's pretty cool for me to I've been doing quite a few rehearsals getting ready for Mummy Versus and NHS Smackdown. Quick plug, I'm doing that this Friday and Saturday in Leicester. I think that's the 6th and 7th of October, so I look forward to doing that. So I believe the Restival kind of started off a bit of a tour. Like, we did some shows in Leeds as well, but yeah, it's pretty great to see more things like that, and I really hope stuff like that really takes off for a lot of different wrestlers.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we had back last year, almost like a few weeks after we launched, we had Heather from Mummy Versus come on to talk to us about that, which seemed really awesome. And things like Mythos as well. I need to get to Mythos. Like, that looks incredible. Like, the work that Crowley and, like, Clementine and the guys are doing over there looks insanely cool. And that's cool as well, isn't it? That the wrestling is known now sort of more in the scene, maybe not to such a wide audience, but in the scene as not just being this, you know, one-on-one or tag team matches in the ring. It can be something else. It can be, you know, a crazy Norse Viking show that just has wrestling aspects, but is more of a theatre production, which is incredible.
Yeah. I think the cool thing with, like, you've already essentially explained Mythos, but it's stuff like Mummy Versus and NHS Smackdown, they tell such personal stories, so it would appeal to a mum or someone who has worked in the NHS. And even if, like, you're not a part of, you know, like, you've never had a kid, or you don't know about what it's like to work in the NHS, like being a wrestling fan and just getting down to those sorts of things, like it really opens your eyes. Like, as fun as it was and how harsh it was on my body physically doing something like a restival, like even emotionally, just hearing these stories like over and over again, it's hard, man. It's hard. But I think it's super important that things like this can be expressed and in such a creative way as well.
Yeah, for sure. That is important. And like you say, it's the sort of thing where they're real stories, aren't they? They're stories that, you know, even if you don't know wrestling or don't like wrestling, you can understand and you can connect with, which I think is like super important. And again, it just gets those new faces in the door, doesn't it? So shout out to everyone at Restival, all doing incredible work. And like, that was a great job they did there. And hopefully, you know, if they come around again, then everyone should go and see them. Obviously we can't have you here without talking about the Eve, without talking about Uprising. Because I think that's probably
girls.
Yeah, exactly. Because I think, as well as your singles work, I think that's probably the thing you're most synonymous with, especially Eve as well related. So we've had Nightshade on to talk about the Uprising as well, and she just like she loves you guys so much, and like it's great. I'm sure it's like the same with all of you. I'm sure it's just like a great family dynamic.
I can't get enough of them.
But so talk to me about sort of like your involvement in terms of joining the Uprising and how it all came about, and like sort of where it started from you, from your perspective, when you know, like you were like, oh, they were like, oh, we're doing this thing, do you want to be part of it, essentially?
It's actually pretty cool for me. I believe it wasn't like an official bit of time off. It wasn't something that like, I announced that, oh, I'm going to be gone for X amount of period. But yeah, like I was just having some of my own personal issues and some things I wanted to get over. And I had Rhea contact me about wanting to like, this is a plan. It's going to happen at Wrestle Queendom. And it was really cool because I hadn't been to an Eve show in a while at that point. I mean, it simply just looked like I was just going down to just hang out and just see people. Like, even quite a few of the girls backstage were like, oh, cool, like, what are you doing today? I'm like, no, I'm just here to hang out. So then when we came out right at the end, they were like, motherfuckers.
Really was a secret. That's great.
Which is awesome. Mm. Awesome.
No, I love that. I love that was like a proper secret.
Sorry.
I was just saying, I love that was like a proper secret, even like with like people in the back, like they didn't actually know what was going on.
Yeah.
No, that's awesome.
I love that. Every now and again, like that Dan pulls out these sorts of things, like especially at Eve, where it's just like you haven't got a clue. Like recently we had Holly Morgan come back, and like I was like, oh, I just imagine she's just here to just hang out and stuff. And then she was like, oh, you're the one. And like, I love it when things like that happens. And like, even the people working the show don't even know. I think it's quite cool, quite new.
Yeah, I think that's important, isn't it? Especially for like the people in the back who are so used to knowing what's going on the show, to get those little moments of surprise as well with the fans. I think that's so nice. But what about you guys? Like I said, we've had Nightshade on. And again, like, I think, From what she's saying, and obviously her at the time of we're recording this, her and Rhea are over in Japan, smashing it, which is incredible. I imagine that's something you'd like the chance to do as well if it came up. But also, you know, it just seems like she especially wants sort of like the end of this year and next year to be sort of the Uprising really dominating, not just in Eve, but around the country.
I very much agree with her on that. It's nice to get us more known, like elsewhere. Like we do our own like little promotions, like promotional thing, like online. Like we've got a T-shirt. We hit up the photographers to get some A4 pictures out and stuff like that. And then there'll be times where like we're all on a show, or some of us are on the show, and even though we're just brought in as like singles wrestlers, like we just end up kind of naturally gravitating towards each other. Like, we don't mean it to be a thing, but it just happens to be a thing. So it'd be quite cool for us to like, especially when the girls come back from Japan, to have more of an official going everywhere.
For sure. And I like to, a little, not too much, but a little bit on this podcast, stir the pot a little. So I've got to ask, just kayfabe-wise, I mean, have the Uprising been in contact with Skye Smitson to see if she's fully, you know, left the Uprising to join the Lana Austin Experience in Progress? You know, what's going on there?
Oh, wow. You do like to stir the pot, don't you? No, Sky's forever. She. That girl gets about in her different groups, and we all fully support it. We love seeing her out. I love these other teams that she's with, but now she's uprising forever. Uprising forever.
Love it, and very, very, very tactfully spoken about as well. I appreciate that. I appreciate that. Really good. I like that. I like that. But again, and that's sort of as well, isn't it? I think that for all of you guys, the fact that you're not just the uprising, the fact that you've got your own stuff going on aside from that, so that people don't always just associate you with that. And like when you're all together, that's fab, and they can be like, "Oh, the uprising here, that's incredible." But when you're on your own, like certain shows, or if you're in different factions on certain shows, then you can be part of that. It doesn't always have to be like, "Oh, that's the wrestler from the uprising in this group."
Very much so. Like, as much as we are all women that came together with the same sort of ethos of just wanting to really smash it and stir shit up, like especially like in Eve, like when we got together, we took that forward. We saw Skye. Skye was very much up and coming and really, really getting herself out there. I think this is just right after. She did quite a lot with WXW. I think she must have gone over for like a couple of weeks or so, did like a few training camps, and she was like really picking shit up, which was awesome. So it's so great to have her in with us, and we all have the same sort of thought process, and we all know what we want, but we're still very much like individuals. We have our own like individual styles and what it is that we do.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And I think that's really important as well. I mean, the final sort of uprising focus question here, because I asked Nightshade, and it would be unfair of me to not ask you as well because I asked her. So the question, and again, it sort of stirs the pot a little, but the question is simply that if you were to win tag team gold again as the uprising, and it was yourself, and you could only pick one other member of the uprising to hold the belts with, who would you pick?
Oh, God damn. Oh, geez. That's really difficult, but I'm gonna get so much heat in the group chat later. I think I'd go for Rhea because just when I was younger and starting out, she was one of the few people that I was having quite a few like regular matches here and there with, and like so she's helped me out since I've started my career, like probably about 8 years ago now. So it's so cool to be a part of a group where like. We're equals, and we're just really I can't explain it. Like we just really it's really cool to to see her as an equal, whereas back then like she was like the vet one, and I was like the young up and coming one, and now we're just both out here smashing it. So yeah, I'd love to get some tag titles in the boat.
Yeah, that'd be cool. That'd be cool. On a tangent with that, as you mentioned
Still love you, Sky. Still love you, Nightshade.
Good thing you got that in there. Yeah, they'll appreciate that. Yeah, you don't want too much heat. You don't want too much heat. But I mean, on a tangent there, from what you just said, now that you picked that up, that's really interesting because, like, is that almost like a for yourself a like a pinch yourself moment that when you started, Rhea was like already into her career and you were looking up to her, and now you're sort of on that level playing with her. Is that like a like, oh, this is really cool sort of moment?
Yeah, it's super cool because I've seen quite a few of her matches at Shimmer, and I'm like, oh my God, I'd love to go to Shimmer. How cool would that be? Actually, exact same thing with Jetta. I've had multiple matches with her in the past. So when it came to me just going out there and just being my own sort of wrestler, away from like my younger self, like it was really cool for me to go on to keep having a match with Jetta, where she's obviously grown as a performer herself, and I've been able to find my sort of style and what I do, and like recreate that match, but in a completely different environment. Like I love that stuff.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And I want to ask you about just Eve as well, in terms of this is going out just a few weeks before Wrestle Queendom. And I want to know about sort of like the buzz surrounding that, because I know obviously Eve is not like WWE or AEW where it's a weekly show and like the sort of build up to big events is run weekly. But it seems like Eve and Queendom is the still the sort of company where there is that like buzz and build up to like this big event that happens every year. Like, does it feel like that when you're at shows that like a few months before Queendom and stuff like that, or like again in group chats and stuff when Queendom's coming up, does it feel like that buzz of like people wanting to get on the card, people wanting matches, but also just even if you're not being like really excited that this huge event is happening?
Like, very much so. But the thing about Queendom is, like, especially in the UK for women, it's such a huge showcase show.
Mm.
And the sort of performers you get on there, like, you never know where it can meet. Like, there's quite a lot of Japanese talent that's going to be on this next one. So who knows if the right person's... So, like... Yeah, like it's always an excitement thing. Like, I like there are so many girls out there that really want to get on Queendom, and like not everyone can make it, but just going down, showing your face, like you never know what could happen last minute. Mm. Someone's injured, maybe you can get out there and then show people what you've got. But I think that's the vibe with quite a lot of females, of wanting to just go out there and just show what they can on such a wide stage. Like, it's Eve's WrestleMania essentially.
Yeah, which is awesome, which is great, and like big up for that. We can't wait for Queendom. It's going to be absolutely phenomenal this year as well. I want to ask just about your like singles career as well, in terms of like, again, the last sort of 12 months, it seems like you've been getting out there as a singles wrestler as well, having some really good matches. Do you feel like, I guess just in yourself, whether it's teaming or in singles, do you feel like you're sort of still growing and learning as a performer and as a wrestler in the ring?
Very much so. Like, I'm definitely my harshest critic. Like, it's interesting to see how I'm perceived, like, on social medias and stuff. And, like, I'm always asking for feedback of, again, like, the likes of Sky and Rhea and Nightshade and, like, whoever I can. But, yeah, like, I always feel like I'm growing, and there's always something more to prove. Like, I want to be able to just stand alone, and I want someone to specifically come to a show to be like, oh, Livy Grace is on it. I really want to see her perform. Like, as I guess as probably egotistical as that says, but like, or sounds, sorry.
Mm.
But yeah, that's definitely what I want for me. So I'm going to keep on working towards that, and I'll pick up even more scene going into the future.
Awesome. Love that. Love to hear that. And we can't wait to see that. Hopefully in the next few months, into the next year, that'd be amazing. That'd be amazing to see. We're going to move on to our sort of like first feature of the show, because it sort of harks back. I was going to save it to later, but it sort of harks back to what you were saying about the beginning of your career. So this feature is called What's in a Name? And it's very simple. It does what it says on the tin. I just want to know sort of like the backstory behind your wrestling name. But I don't want to know about Livy Grace. I want to know about Tennessee Honey.
Oh, God damn.
So, where did that come from? What was the origin of that? And, like, how did you feel wrestling under that persona? Because it's very different to who you are now.
So, the origin of that is, I must have been after a wrestling show years and years ago. And then just someone just had a bottle of, like, we were just having, like, a bit of a pre-drinks, if anything. And then someone just had, like, a bottle of JD Honey, and it just came up. It's like just chatting shit, essentially. It's like, oh, you know what your gimmick should be? Tennessee Honey. You should be a cowgirl, and that's what you're going to be called. And I was like, ah, yeah, that's funny. But then it became a bit more frequent and a bit more of a thing, and then it kind of materialized. that's essentially it.
How did you feel in like the whole cowgirl get up? Like, how was that for you as an experience?
Like, because when I first started wrestling, I just literally went under the name Olivia. I didn't have a surname or anything. Like, it was just Olivia. And then I tried messing about with the name Livy Bray. But Bray is just an anagram of my middle name.
Mm.
So I was trying to mess about with that. So at least it was like a name that was somewhat relative to just me as a person. And what was it? I believe it was a trainee show. That was a gauntlet match. And I initially came out as Livy Bray.
Mm.
And then ended up coming back as Tennessee Honey. And then won the whole thing. And it just kind of progressed from there. But it's like, I don't even... It's like, I can't even resent the character just because, like, it was something, you know? It was just like, well, you're not really going to see a black female cowgirl, like, everywhere.
It's unique.
In time, I did, like, kind of get on board of it, and I wanted to make it as best as I could. But, like, what I was saying earlier about, like, having matches with Rhea O'Reilly's and the Jetta, like, some of my best matches when back then were against Jetta for a championship, which was outstanding. For me, my most notable match was against Mickey James as Tennessee Honey. I'd absolutely love to wrestle her now because I know so much more and I'm so much better. But even when I've watched that match back, like, I think I did pretty well. I think it was a pretty good match. So, yeah. Like, it gave me quite a lot of opportunities starting from that. But for me, I just had a natural wanting to move away from that.
Sure.
Actually just become my own being and just do what I want to do.
Yeah, no, that's cool. I respect that. I actually had down, because of that, the match with Mickey James, I had it down to ask you, because she's got her whole sort of like almost like cowgirl, yeah, like country girl vibe. Like, did she say anything?
Not that I remember. No, but it's kind of one of those moments where it's just like, you're going for your gear case and it's like, oh, I pick out the jean shorts, she picks out the jean shorts, and it's like a Spider-Man moment there. It didn't really come out. It was just that that's just what I was. I really enjoyed the match. She's an absolutely fantastic woman. And that's such a surreal moment in my career of, like, growing up watching Mickey James, like, her Trish Stratus and, like, her psycho gimmick and, like, that whole story and just how interesting it was for that sort of time in divas wrestling, like, to be in a singles match with her for a championship was insane.
Yeah, I was gonna say, because I guess it's just sort of like recency bias, because we've spoken to loads of wrestlers about it, but recency bias sends me to just this month of podcasts we've recorded, and we spoke to Warren Banks about his match with John Morrison, and Leon Slater for his match with Speedball Mike Bailey, and Ojmo about his match with Ospreay as well, and like those sort of pinch yourself moments in wrestling, like, how do you keep it focused in the ring, like, on your job, when you're like looking over the ring and you're like, holy shit, that's Mickey James, like.
it's so weird to say. It's like, I'm probably in the corner having like a mild panic attack somewhere, but then your music hits and you get out there and like a switch turns on and you just go out there and do what you got to do. Like the character turns on, you're there to do a job and you want to do the best that you can. So you kind of put all of that completely aside. But there are moments like, I feel like we're just naturally organic where we're just having a little bit of a laugh before it starts getting a bit more competitive, where it's just like, wow, that's Mickey James right there.
Yeah, that's crazy cool. I love that. Well, mention of this month brings us on to sort of like, again, one of the focuses we're here to talk about. And like I said, over the course of these ones we've recorded, recorded with Ojmo, which hasn't gone out yet at the time this goes out. That hasn't gone out yet. And Roy Johnson hasn't gone out yet. But we've had Leon and Warren Banks, which ones have gone out. And we've just been talking to everyone we've had on about representation in British wrestling specifically, and whether people think it's like growing. I mean, as a fan, as an outsider, and I know that a lot of them felt the same as well, it does seem like representation, not just in the black community, but as a whole in terms of like minority communities, has improved in wrestling in the last few years vastly. I mean, is that something that you can attest to as someone who, like you said, has been in the business about sort of 8 years now? Like, have you seen that momentum, that growth and change maybe in representation?
Like, from when I started, I could probably name one or two other black females wrestling. And then that was just kind of it. Then it was just like watching Jazz and Ivory on WWE and stuff. So for me, it's really cool as I've gotten older to see some just newer talent that happen to be people of colour and that are female. I think that's great, and I really hope that there are young black females out there that maybe pop down to like a local show, sees one of us, and they're just like, oh, cool, like that's awesome. Like nowadays, like outside of the British wrestling scene, like you've got the Sasha Banks and the Naomi's that, like, when I was growing up, I would have loved to have had more of those sorts of females around. And so, like, I'm not sure how great of a job I'm doing at it, but I hope occasionally that there is, like, a young ethnic female who sees me or one of the other girls, and they're just like, wow, maybe I can go down to a training school and maybe this is something that I can do.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's what's important, isn't it? Like you mentioned it there, it's about that representation of you know, someone, you know, a young kid watching a show over here, and, you know, seeing all these wrestlers on WWE and stuff, but then coming across like a poster or a match card over here and being like, oh, that's someone I can identify with. Like, so this is a clear, like, career path for me because I see people that look like me doing it.
Very, very, very much like that.
And what about, because I want to talk to you specifically about like the women in the scene, because there's loads of fantastic like black women in the scene at the minute, but it does seem that, like, especially in terms of, say, if you were to compare it specifically to, say, like black male competitors, there is still a bit of a way to go. There seems to be, at least from an outsider point of view, maybe you can attest differently, but a lot fewer black female wrestlers on the scene, the British scene specifically, than there are men. I mean, is that something that you think can still improve and can still sort of be worked on?
100%. Like, I'm not sure if there are just black females out there, or again, just any ethnic females out there, like, maybe just aren't interested, or maybe they're finding a school where they feel comfortable, where maybe they would like an ethnic female to be a head trainer or something like that. Like, I'm not sure what it would actually take, but a majority of schools that I frequent at the moment, like, happily take anyone and everyone, but, like, anyone that happens to watch this, like, come on down, man, like, come try it out, maybe this is something for you, but.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it is, thinking back, there aren't personally, like, a lot of ethnic females that I see at training schools, which is a little bit disheartening, because unfortunately, from when I started to now, like, it has gotten better, but there's still quite a large gap with that.
Yeah, for sure. And that's the thing as well, isn't it? I mean, like, again, we'll like talk about the positive for a bit though, because there are still so many, like, out there, like yourself and Mercedes Blaze and Rio and Tonga and Ronnie Knox, and even like past the black community, like people like Kanji as well, like, absolutely killing it on the scene. That is an inspiration, right? That is an inspiration for young people watching. Be like, oh, I can achieve this because I see people like me achieving this. And that's just really great to see as well. It's great to see as well in terms of, we've spoken to as well, the other wrestlers we've spoken to about this say that it's really great to see these wrestlers now, especially compared to maybe like 5 years ago, 10 years ago, being booked as like, oh, these are just brilliant wrestlers, not just like, oh, this is the token ethnic wrestler we need on the card.
Yeah.
Like, these, like again, everyone I just mentioned, including yourself, like, earning these spots on the cards because you're just brilliant at your job, regardless of, like, race.
Like, this is why it's so important that a Roy Johnson does have something like an Everything Pattern. Mm. Like, I'm biased, but that show was absolutely outstanding. Mm. Like, the ethnic talents that are out there, like, everyone's smashing it. Like, and there truly is room for everyone, but it just depends on promoters and what they want, and I guess people's budgets and stuff. But it's a shame because, like, you think about cost of living and how some promotions probably aren't running anywhere near as much. Like, even like an Everything Pattern, that's been like once this year. It hasn't been like a regular thing, and like I hope in time it can become like a regular thing to keep renewing and bringing more people in. Like, I think it really is something to aspire to, like, as an ethnic person, to this is a show filled with people that I relate to that probably have been discriminated against or haven't been featured on a poster, or it's just like I guess I'll book you because that adds that ticks a box for that show, but it really shouldn't be like that. But yeah, I don't really know what to say with like how we can get more people out there. But Everything Pattern is such a great start for it. It
really is. For sure. And like I said, we had Roy on as part of this month's podcast. It's going out the week after your one goes out. But he was talking about Everything Pattern and like the first one he ran and how he really struggled to book it because there just weren't that many ethnic people on the scene. And then like this year's one or the one he did with Progress, he was like having to turn people away because there were so many people that wanted to be part of it. And that just shows how far representation has come in British wrestling, really. And that's that's a really good thing to see. Like, it's just like crazy that that growth can be over like that short space of time where suddenly he's got like no wrestlers to book to everyone wants to be on that card. Like, yeah, that's just so crazy.
Like, again, like, if Everything Pattern could be more of a regular thing, then I think it can drum up the clientele of getting these young ethnics or just ethnics in general that want to go out and, maybe I can go try and wrestle. Like, how can I get into this? And maybe they just don't know, like.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, in terms of sort of, like, moving back to your training experience, and I know you mentioned it before, but, like, coming up as, a young black wrestler, and, like you said, not seeing, like, many other black wrestlers in training schools, is that the sort of thing where, because we've spoken to others about this, the one others we've spoken to, Warren and Leon and all that, have spoken, you know, about how it's tough because, again, almost like with fans, you don't see anyone who can relate to your story, your experience.
Yeah.
And so it's tricky to get into training because you see all these people that aren't really like you, apart from the love of wrestling. I mean, for yourself, is it the sort of thing where, like, maybe you had to feel like you had to, like, prove yourself that bit more or, like, work that bit harder to get noticed because of that?
I think I'm pretty lucky in saying that when I started training, like, I say lucky, but when I started training, there just weren't even a lot of females full stop.
Right.
So me being the person of colour didn't really hinder anything because they just needed, they needed girls. So I remember there was just me and one other girl, and then they'd need to get the Rears in, the Addy Stars, the Jetters, to beef up the roster because in the area there just weren't enough girls. So luckily for me, I never felt that sort of direct discrimination of there's all these women, but then like how am I supposed to stand out, like being the person of color? I would say it'd be a lot harder for men, as there are so many more male wrestlers, with a lot more of them most likely being white.
Yeah, for sure. But again, that brings up another sort of like another great growth in British wrestling over the last few years, being women's wrestling, and the fact that there's so many, like, regardless of colour now, like, so many great women on the scene who are absolutely smashing it when 10 years ago maybe that wasn't the case. Or like maybe they just weren't getting noticed as much because women's wrestling wasn't as featured as much. But now it seems like you look at, you know, in like, say, maybe like the top five, top 10 British wrestlers in the country at the minute, like, you'd say like at least half, if not more, are female, probably.
Yeah, very much so. Like, I think there was, again, like when I started training, what I was seeing on like WWE was like the Divas and like the Brian Panties matches. So when I watched like these drop dead gorgeous girls, like, I didn't relate to that. Like, I'm just really into wrestling, and like, I wanted to wrestle like a Bryan Danielson's or like a Shelton Benjamin. Like, I wanted to have that sort of style of wrestling. So I think that same fire burnt for so many other girls at like different times. And in terms of being female and in wrestling, like, we've all felt like we've had to work 10 times harder just for someone to notice us. Because, like, a majority of the time, well, back then, it was just being put on the show just to, again, tick a box. Like, I imagine that there are definitely times where, some shows where I get put on because I tick two boxes of being ethnic and female. And, like, it's not right to do it like that. I'm going to be booked because I'm good enough.
Yeah.
And in this day and age now, like, so many people are so good where it's just, like, one match isn't enough for girls anymore. Like, you can have half the card, you can have whole women's shows and stuff like that.
Mm.
It's all just wrestling in the end, like, but the talent out there has grown vastly from what it used to be. Yeah.
I think, like, we had, and again, I think, like, Dan Reed at Eve, again, we had him on the podcast to talk about that. And I think that sort of, again, talking about that, lit that extra flame in him as well, because he started, like, his, like, one-hour challenge sort of promos after that, in terms of, like, we spoke to him about the fact that, essentially, it's the fact that if you have one women's match on the card, you don't have a women's division, because that's doing it a disservice, because there's so much great talent there that you can have a whole card of it. You don't need just one match.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and that's, I think that's testament to the talent we have over here now, which is great to see.
Mm-hmm.
Which is brilliant.
It's absolutely insane. And, like, so many girls going out to Japan, going out to America, going out in Europe. There's a lot of European talent that are coming over to the UK, and everyone's getting everywhere, and I actually love to see it. Like, I'm just like, yeah, get me involved. Like, let's do this. I love it.
So in terms of, like, sort of closing out our representation section of this podcast, in terms of, again, you sort of mentioned it, but if somehow any sort of, like, young wannabe, like, female wrestlers of, like, sort of, like, ethnic backgrounds come across this and want to get into wrestling, what would you say to them to encourage them to get involved, and, you know, even if there are sort of, like, hurdles to jump over, to get involved, to give it their all and be part of this, and the fact that they'd be welcomed into it?
Like, you just never know where it's going to take you. Like, when I jumped in, like, I was just completely blinded by how much my heart burns for wrestling. Like, I don't even remember my first training session hurting, because I was just like, oh my god, this is the coolest thing ever. And it's just like, you literally don't know where it's going to take you. Like I have times where, like, I get to wrestle one of my best mates, Rhea O'Reilly, or I get put in a match with Mickey James. Like, you just haven't got a clue where it could possibly go, and you're never going to know until you look at your nearest school, or just travel out, or even if you just did one just to get out of your system. You might do it, you might absolutely hate it, or you might do it and it might be, like, a really long journey for you. So, like, please just go out there and give it a go. Like, you never know what can happen.
Love it. And I really appreciate you being so open and honest in that section. It means a lot to me to hear you, like, speak, like, so openly about it, because I know, like, representation can be, like, a tricky issue to get through, but at the end of the day, speaking about it always helps, right? That's what we're here for. And, like,
Of course.
I really do appreciate that. And that, like, you speak about not knowing where it leads you, and that leads us on to something you mentioned earlier about Apocalypse WoW. I want to know how this all came about, because, again, we talk about, like, theatre and wrestling being mixed, and, like, that is very much a sort of case for it, in the fact that, again, I mean, it must have been so cool to be on, like, sort of, like, a national spotlight, but also, like, talk me through it. Like, how did this happen? How did this come about? And then to be there filming it, what was that like compared to, like, how you film, like, or not how you film, how you act, like, at a wrestling show?
My God, yeah, it was an absolute blast. Like, so I've got a wrestling email, Libby Grace Bookings, if anyone's looking, yeah.
Get Libby booked. Plug that.
Yeah, get Libby booked, man, yeah. So I was just going through my emails, and I just had this one, and, like, I was reading it, and I was just like, okay, what? Like, it just read completely mental. It's like, I'd never actually heard of Apocalypse WoW, the show, prior to getting the email. Like, I was sent a link of, this is what the trailer for last year looks like. This is the sort of thing that we do. It's kind of like Gladiators / 50 Shades of Grey. And I'm just like, okay, this sounds like a mental ride. I'm definitely going to reply to this. Got to chatting over email. Like, I ended up having a Skype call, sending over, like, doing, like, a bit of an audition. I ended up getting the goddamn job, and, like, it was the most insane thing to be, like, I was hyped as fuck. I was nervous as hell, though. I was so nervous, because I'm just like, I haven't done a TV-related thing, like, ever before by that point. But I got there, and, like, we did rehearsals for, like, the games, and
Just like, a bit of a, like a roller coaster. Show,
it was as crazy as what it came across. Like,
it does come across wild. It does come across pretty.
And, sorry?
It does come across pretty wild. Sorry, like, yeah. It comes across as a bit of a, like, everywhere sort of thing. Like, I mean, 50 Shades of Grey meets Gladiators is a weird way to describe it, but I can't say it's wrong. It's just very weird.
Yeah. But, like, I met so many amazing people. Like, some of the other super bosses we were called. Like, it was so great to hear about, like, what they do and how they got involved. Like, were they in the last series? And it was nice to just get to chatting about that, to see if, like, is this something that I could also pursue? Can I do more of this in the future? And again, it's completely insane to me because, like, I got contacted because I was a wrestler. So going back to, like, getting young talent in, like, you literally have no idea what could possibly happen. If someone told me that, oh, you're probably going to be on ITV2 this year, a show called Apocalypse Well, and there's going to be some, like, God, it was out there, lube and fire dances, and yeah, it was a ride, but
I imagine it's.
I'm so glad that I could do it.
I imagine it's a very different experience to sort of walking out to the ring at a wrestling show, being like.
Like, you'd say that. Like, I think it was more comedic, if anything, for what I would normally do. Like, me as Livy Grace, like, doing my entrance, where it's just me. Like, I wanted a specific type of character, which I could do for them. That's what I did when I went out there. They wanted an entrance. There were fire dancers. There was, like, this big dome, and there were people just, like, on the sides, like, just chanting your name and stuff like that. Well, my name on the show was Pandora. Like, it was like, you go out there, you stand on your point, you look at the camera, you do something crazy, and yeah. Absolute wild ride, if anything. Like,
yeah,
me doing wrestling completely helps.
Oh, for sure. Like,
that whole endeavor, yeah.
Yeah, I love that. It's crazy. There's been, like, a few wrestlers have been on, like, TV shows as well because of that. And that's the thing, I think, being a professional wrestler, like, people sometimes give it a hard time, like, oh, it's not a real sport. But, like, it gets you these other venues, like, these other ventures where you can do stuff that other people just can't do because you've trained to do that. And, like, in that scenario, it comes out perfectly. And you get those opportunities.
Exactly that, yeah.
Which is cool, which is crazy cool. I love that. Well, we got a couple of sort of, like, fun features to end on here. One of them is a relatively new one. It's called Hot Takes. And it's essentially not the thing that would get you cancelled, but the opinion you have, the opinion you have either on social media or, like, even within, like, just, like, you know, your friends group, the opinion that you have that people look at you like, that's weird that you think that. Like, so the example I give, and it doesn't have to be food related, it doesn't have to be wrestling related, but the example I give is that I always say that, like, pasta is super overrated for me. I don't get the hype around pasta. Like,
oh, wow.
Like, I'd rather have rice or bread or potato than pasta. So I don't get this pasta love, but that's just me, right? And that's the thing people look at me and they're like, you're mental, pasta's great. And I just don't get it. But, like, so what would that be for you, like, in terms of the thing that you really back, you really stand for, that other people are like, there's no way you can, like that or not like that.
Oh, I'm trying to think. Is there anything really weird? Well, this is a very interesting question. I haven't been asked anything like this for it to just be on my mind.
I mean, if it helps, like, again, actually a lot of them have been food related, the answers we've had. Like, Rob Brazier said that his was cucumber. Like, he can't stand cucumber. And I thought that was weird. But, like, just anything that you sort of either like or don't like, that the general sort of population would be like, that's odd.
Okay, so I've got, like, isn't, like, a daily thing that I have, but, like, I'm a bit of a fan of, like, the overlapping in taste of cheese and onion crisps and, like, a yogurt.
Oh. Oh, okay.
I I don't know what it is about it. Like
what? Like you dip it into the yogurt, or?
See, you'd think that, but no. It's just like it's just a bit of overlap in the mouth, which probably isn't.
So you have the crisp, and it's like a yogurt chaser.
Yeah, kind of like that. Yeah.
Right, that is very weird.
Yogurt could be a pettifaloo or a froob. That's where I'm at with that.
Right, yeah. Something like super sweet.
Cheese and onion crisps and a yogurt.
That is a hot take. That is
not
weird.
Like a dip in like salsa. That's too crazy.
That's too weird.
That's a bit much for me. But yeah, probably likened to a bit of a chaser where like you've got the flavour of the crisp in there. And then you have a spoonful of the yogurt, and yeah.
I see. All right, I might have to give that a go. I mean, it's bizarre, but I might have to give it a go. Well, in terms of like getting to know you outside the ring, that was a great start, and that leads us on to our like closing feature here, because this is called Anatomy of a Pro Wrestler. So this is essentially what makes you. I like to call it. So I'm just going to throw a few questions out there, and you let me know what comes to mind. So the first one is my favorite pre-show meal.
Oh, pre-show meal. I love a bowl of skin-on fries.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice, like that, like really crisp and everything.
Yeah, like super crisp. So it's a bit light, but I could just demolish that. And then probably just go get a kebab later. So,
nice. Well, that's the thing. You answer that because the next one is my favorite post pinfall pig out.
Post pinfall. Okay. I will retract that. It actually isn't a kebab. I don't think I've had a kebab in a while, but it's probably. I'm a huge fan of a ready meal.
Really nice and simple.
Yeah, just like a Tesco's like green Thai curry.
Nice.
Or like a carbonara. Something that I just know is home. I don't really have to do anything. Stick it in the microwave and then you just go to bed because I'm really exhausted from the day.
Yeah, and you don't have to spend a ton of money on like takeout or like drive through either.
Yeah.
I like that. I respect that. I like that. And the final food-based one is just your favourite food in general.
Ooh, favourite food in general. I am a huge fan of Mexican food. I really love tacos. Yeah, big fan of that, like a fajita, just Mexican food in general.
Nice. Yeah, love it. And London's a great place for it as well. I don't know if you're still based in London, but London's a great place for like just general.
Yeah, nearby. Like there's a place in Borough Market. I can't remember what it's called, but I really need to go there. There used to be one close by to me in Bromley called Benito's Hat. Used to go there all the goddamn time.
Nice.
It became a little bit of a problem, so I'm kind of glad that it's closed down.
Spending too much money on it, too much time. Yeah. There. I get that. I get those vibes. I understand that. I have my own that I'm like that with. I'm like, oh my god, I'm spending too much money here. This is not good. Love that. The next one is the song that gets me the most hyped.
Oh shoot! Ooh, what gets me hyped? I love this artist so much. It is most likely Ariana Grande's Seven Rings.
Nice. I like it. It's not my sort of music, but I respect it. I respect it as a song. But no, that's cool.
I appreciate that.
Yeah. Well, leading on from that, it might be that answer because the next one is my favorite band / artist of all time.
Oh, of all time, Nirvana.
Nice. I like that. Yeah.
Absolutely love Nirvana.
Yeah, Nirvana Killer, they were great. Oh, no, that's good. That's more my style, see. That's like, I was raised on like metal and rock and like grunge and all that. So like, that's all my sort of
jam. Nice.
So that's, yeah.
It's like, if I'm honest, that is more what I listen to, but I do have such a soft spot for Ariana Grande.
Sure, like pumps you up. Yeah, I like that. That's good. I get it. The next one, I'm very similar with like 60s music is my differential to that. Like things like the Kinks and like the Turtles and stuff like that. Like that's really,
nice.
Like, yeah, that's like very different to what I listen to for the stuff. I'm just like, oh, it's so good. Even though it's so different to the thing I normally like. The next one is the best gig that I've ever been to.
I haven't been to a lot of gigs, but I did recently go to one, a band called Vended. That's Corey Taylor's.
Oh, yeah. How were they?
Yeah, that was so good. It was so good.
Were they? I've not had a chance to see them live, but like they're crazy good.
It was actually at the Black Heart in Camden, but they really smashed it. Yeah.
Nice. Oh, that's good. That's cool. I like to hear that. I like to hear that because like. I think that's a lot. That's a big shadow to live up to, isn't it? Like that's big shoes to fill. When you're like, oh, they're like a couple of them are the sons of Slipknot members. You're like, oh shit, that's pressure. That's pressure you don't need.
The band before them is called Graphic Nature, who randomly has a guy who I was friends with in primary school.
Oh, that's weird.
And I'm just like, oh my god, hey, what the hell? And he's like, oh, Olivia, what the hell? So cool.
That's super weird. I love that. That's brilliant. Amazing. The next one is the movie that I show the locker room.
So I imagine that's like your favorite movie.
Yeah, essentially. It doesn't have to be your favorite movie, but like essentially the movie that you think everyone should see, which I guess should be your favorite movie, but it doesn't have to be.
I'm going to go favorite movie. I'm not that much of a movie person, but I absolutely love Kindergarten Cop.
Oh, that's weird. That's a weird choice. That should have been your hot take. I can't stand that. I'm sorry. I can't back that.
I love it.
Kindergarten Cop. Oh.
You deserve an Oscar for it. Outstanding work. Everyone can fight me. Let's go.
I think they will fight. They'll be like, why are you making us watch this? That's brilliant. That's my favorite answer we've ever had to that question. I mean, we've had answers that I've loved and totally backed, but this is above and beyond anything I ever thought anyone would say.
And this is just a very legitimate thing for me as well.
Amazing. You'll back that. This is like the hill you'll die on. This is like
100%. Yeah.
Amazing. I love it. The next way is my favorite way to relax.
Way to relax, I'd probably say I'm a huge fan of napping, and because like the years of wrestling, my body just constantly hurts. So like a little lay down in bed, like probably have Netflix on and just zoning out. Maybe I'm listening to music on my phone as well as Netflix being on. Yes, yeah, something like that. Like something's always playing in the background.
Yeah, a cocoon of noise to like settle.
Yeah, just general noise.
Yeah. Love it. Although I respect the fact that you can nap. I can't nap. I can't sleep in the day. Like, I want to.
Oh, really?
The desire is there, but I can't do it.
Oh, that's infuriating.
No, it's bad. I'm like just constantly tired because of it. But, you press on. the next one's a bit of a throwback because it's my first job.
Oh, my first job. I was I essentially worked as a receptionist at like a recruitment agency.
Right. Okay. Fair enough.
Yeah, that was like in Old Kent Road. I lucked out on the job because my uncle was the boss, so it was like a summer job for me. It was something to do in between either just school or university, so that was pretty cool for me.
Nice, yeah, a bit of extra money. Can't hurt, can't it? For a first job, that's what you want, isn't it? You just want a bit of easy money, and that's like... That's a win.
Yeah.
Cool. The next one is, if I wasn't a wrestler, I'd be...
I'm kind of doing both at the moment. I'd be an engineer,
yeah.
And I am an engineer. Like, when I went to university, I studied mechanical engineering, so I've got a degree in mechanical engineering, and that's why I work as a production engineer by day. So if I didn't have wrestling, I'd still be on the path of just being an engineer.
Nice, that's cool. So that was always like the path for you in terms of career-wise. That was always like that's what you planned to do.
Oh yeah, like I full-on planned to be a wrestler and an engineer. Like there was nothing that was going to stop either of those from happening.
Love it, and you've achieved both, so there you go.
Yeah, I know, how sick is that?
Cool. I love that.
And I've got on TV.
And you've got on TV. That's just the outlier, that's just like the crazy extra cool thing that you got to do. I love that. The next one is my favourite animal.
Oh, I'm going to say a dog.
Nice, yeah.
I'm pretty sure that's just really basic. I can't even tell you like breeds of dogs or stuff, but like I'm walking down the street and I see a cute dog, like I'm just staring at that dog.
Yeah,
like, it love it. The joy that they bring from just being alive is insane.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Like, they totally do that, don't they? And that's the thing. I'm very, like, guilty of that as well. And I always have, like, this, like, anxiety in the back of my mind. I'm like, I hope that person thinks I'm not staring at them. I hope they know I'm staring at their dog, not them. Because that would look weird.
Yeah.
No, I get that. I get that. The next one gets a little bit deep because it's my greatest fear.
Ooh, greatest fear. What am I afraid of? Wow, this is,
It doesn't have to be anything super deep if, like, you know, like...
Yeah, that's fair enough. Like, I don't think I'm, like, deathly or deeply afraid of a lot of things, but, like, keeping it basic, like, I'm not a fan of spiders.
Yeah, I'm the same. I don't like spiders.
It's like, I would happily get, still, as an adult woman, get my mum to deal with a spider, like, wholeheartedly. Like, if it's in my room, then I'm gonna have to just leave the house. I'm gonna just have to burn the house down.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Yeah, make sure you get out the insurance first, but...
Yeah.
I like that. No, that's what I relate to that. I'm always like, if there's a spider, I'm like to my partner, I'm like, you're dealing with that. I'm going to go in the other room. Let me know when it's gone.
I'm going to go.
I relate. I get that. A couple of wrestling ones now. The next one is, it's a two-parter because it's my favourite wrestling match. And I'm going to ask you for one you've been in and one that you've watched.
Oh, God. One that I've been in, I'll probably go back to Mickie James.
Yeah.
Like, again, just never in my lifetime did I think that would be an option for me.
Mm.
And again, just watching it back, like, and just thinking about how I felt in the moment, like, it's, yeah, insane for me. Absolutely love it.
Nice.
Match that I've watched.
It doesn't have to be live. It can be, like, on TV.
A huge fan of any and all Bret and Shawn matches.
Yeah.
My god damn. Like, the boyhood dream has been realised. Jesus. Yeah. That gets me.
Yeah.
Gets me all the time.
Bret and Shawn are always great because, like, you know about the personal stuff. You know that they just didn't like each other. And the fact that they can not like each other that much and still put on those great matches in an environment where you have to trust each other is crazy. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's awesome. I get that. I relate to that. I get that. The next one is going to be in person, though, the thing that I ask you for, because it's the loudest pop I've ever heard.
Loudest pop I've ever heard. Well, my mind has gone a blank, but there's definitely been times where...
That's the thing. I'm sure there's been too many. And like,
that's... Yeah, if anything, there's been too many. I'm gonna go recent. When Erin Angel came back.
yeah.
For that first show, I believe it was that first show back at Eve, like after the. Oh, it was the Rumble. Yes, I think.
Yeah, it was Queen, wasn't it? Yeah, the Rumble.
Yeah. When she came out, my God, my heart. Oh God! And just watching her take that in, like. She's another one that's always just been there. Like, I've been lucky to have matches with her, considering like how long she's been around. So like, seeing her get that pop, like, love it.
Yeah, I love that. That's a great answer. The next one is my favorite venue to wrestle in.
I'm gonna go Clapham Junction.
Nice.
I've been lucky to wrestle there for two promotions, like more recently Riot Cabaret, but in the past as well. And like, I was supposed to be in a 6-person tag match, and X-Pac was supposed to be in it.
Okay. Okay, I wasn't expecting that.
But unfortunately, he didn't make it to the show. I think there was like some flight issues. So the match went forward, but another replacement was put in. But
okay,
that was the first time I wrestled there. And like, the venue itself is such a performance venue. Mm. Like, it really heightens everything up. So yeah. I absolutely love that, yeah.
Nice. I might know, not because I was there, because I wasn't there, but I might know the match you're talking about just having seen it afterwards, but I didn't know that X-Pac was meant to be in that match.
Yeah.
That's weird.
Yeah.
But you're right, yeah. Clapham is, it's a gorgeous venue, incredible venue. Yeah. Like for something as theatrical as wrestling as well, just perfect fit.
Yeah.
Nice.
The stage lights are pretty hot to wrestle under, but...
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. Oh, it gets a bit toasty in there. Like,
yeah.
Especially going into winter, it's probably nicer to wrestle in there in winter. But at the height of summer, I can imagine it's just an oven.
Yeah.
Love it. A couple of final ones. The next one is my favourite place in the world.
I haven't actually done a lot of like personal travelling, like in terms of holidays and stuff.
Oh, it doesn't have to be in abroad. It can be like Scotty Rourke said it was his bed. So like it's literally just your favourite place in the world.
I'm gonna go pretty broad and generic and say London.
Mm.
It's like I seem to be just venturing out there a lot more, like whether it is for wrestling or just to just go out with some mates, and it's just I love how you can get out of a train station or a tube and like walk down a few roads and then find something that you never knew existed. Like, yeah. I do love that about London.
Yeah, it does have that appeal, doesn't it? Not the cost of living here so much. That's bad. That's not great.
Oh yeah. Like, the prices are absolutely horrendous.
But the city itself has got its charms. It's got its charms.
Yes, very much so.
Well, you mentioned the travel, and that brings us on to the last one, because the last one is my dream holiday destination.
Ooh, dream holiday. That being said, I've actually I've been to Jamaica once, and I'd absolutely love to go again.
Nice.
Like I've seen Nightshade. She not too recently, but she went out there, and it just made me get the itch of just going back out there. Like, I'm gonna have to save up my pennies and get back out there, because it's such a nice chill vibe.
Mm.
The locals are so nice. Like, you just forget everything exists and you just really live in that moment.
Yeah, love it. Nice. Amazing. Well, Libby Grace, thank you so much for coming on the Grapple Theory podcast. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Thanks for having me.
It's been an absolute pleasure having you on. I hope you enjoyed it.
Oh, yeah, delighted. It's been a ride. I actually haven't done a lot of things like this, so it's like...
I'm good.
Thanks for the experience of it.
Of course. I'm glad to help. It's been great having you on. We always end our chats by giving our guest one final piece of promo time. So if anyone sees Libby Grace on a match poster or on social media wrestling near them or on TV even, and wants to come to a show and check you out, be it in the next few months, be it into next year or beyond that, why should people be coming to check out Libby Grace?
Wow, okay. So the thing is about me, like I define myself as a badass. And I define myself as a badass because people have been telling me that. And it's taken me a while to realise that that's exactly what I am. But that is exactly what I am, and that's exactly what people are going to get. So if you want to come see a cool fucking badass, like, you're going to have to come see me.